Okay, well, welcome back, folks. It's our Monday afternoon tour through the music of the 50s and 60s. And as we do every Monday afternoon, let's get us going with good old Bob Seger. Okay, so as we do every Monday afternoon, let's get started with a trivia question. What singer outsold every other recording star in the 1950s other than Elvis Presley? So, and if you guessed Pat Boone,
you were right.
Absolutely right. Pat Boone made a career out of covering rock and roll hit records made by primarily black musicians, had 6 number one hits, 11 others in the top 10, and 20 others in the top 40. Sold over 45 million records in the 1950s. I mean, this guy was absolutely a record producing machine. He was something else. And we're going to hear more about Pat Boone here in a little bit. So I thought I'd get started by playing a song that kind of falls out of the normal category. This is the McGuire Sisters, and they're singing one of their top songs of 1955, Sincerely. So that was the McGuire Sisters. By the way, I've got to tell you the sidelight story here. You know, I'm a historian. I love to tell these stories. The McGuire Sisters were often seen as some of the most wholesome young singers there were. And I'm not saying they were, but Phyllis had the lead singer of the three sisters had a long love affair with a man by the name of Sam Giancana. Sam Giancana was the head of the Chicago Mafia. And, you know, it was like a long time. They were still dating and still basically living together at the same time that he was actually killed in 1975 in a mob hit. She always maintained she knew nothing about his background. She said that she absolutely did not know that he was a mafia kingpin. You know, I guess maybe she was that naive, but that seems a little hard to believe. So anyway, that's the McGuire sisters. So let's review a little bit about what we talked about last week. Last week, we looked at the political, social, cultural events that shaped the year 1955. And we looked at the singles and the Billboard Top 10, and we saw that adult contemporary records, as we might call them, were still the best-selling single records. Rock and roll, as we know it today, was still kind of a new idea out there. It really hadn't become the big, all-encompassing musical genre that we kind of think of today. We saw how the Chords, actually way back in 1954, recorded Shaboom, and the Penguins had recorded a song called Earth Angel, which are generally considered kind of the precursors, if not the first doo-wop songs as such. And then we saw how the Platters came along, and the Platters absolutely had a whole new concept of music that kind of blended Tin Pan Alley and blues and jazz and pop. And their big song in 1955 was Only You. It was just the first of many, many, many number one hits for them, as we'll see throughout the weeks that we look at this music. And finally, we saw the emergence of Ray Charles, who basically is kind of credited with starting the concept of soul music, which kind of blended blues and rhythm and blues and pop along with gospel into a kind of another genre of music, which is kind of under the umbrella of rock and roll and pop music. So that's where we were last week. So let's look at what else transpired in 1955. Now, while the New York record producers and the Los Angeles record producers were out scurrying the ghettos looking for these black groups that were singing like the Chords and the Penguins and, all this, there was a guy in Chicago that was really dedicated to recording the blues. And in at least in the beginning, he didn't really venture into rock and roll. A man by the name of Leonard Chess actually had a brother, started a record company called Chess Records. And he was extremely important in recording what generally became known as the Chicago Blues, which had a really direct impact on the future of rock and roll music. Most of these blues musicians that we saw had immigrated north from a lot of them from the Mississippi Delta region in what was called the Great Migration of the 30s and early 40s. Three of them really stand out. The first one is a man by the name of McKinley Morganfield. We know him better as Muddy Waters. That was the name he took, named after obviously the Mississippi River. Grown up on the Stovall Plantation that we talked about back when we were talking about the roots of pop music. And he was heard by a traveling musicologist, a man by the name of Alan Lomax, that was out recording these primitive blues musicians for the Library of Congress. And he told Waters, he said, you know, you're really good. You've got a future in recording if you get somewhere where they could record you. So he got on the train and took off to Chicago, where he was going to pursue a recording career. And did he ever? He was signed eventually by Chess Records, and he is generally considered to be kind of the father of Chicago blues. Remember, Chicago blues kind of differed from the other types of blues in that they lean more heavily upon the use of electric instruments, and particularly the harmonica, which we'll see here in a few minutes. Another one that came from the Delta region that traveled to Chicago and was signed by Chess Records with a man by the name of Chester Arthur Burnett. We know him as Howlin' Wolf. Howlin' Wolf originally was signed by Sam Turner at the Sun Studios. Sam Phillips. One of a second there. He was encouraged by Turner to sign with Sam Phillips. And Phillips praised his singing, saying that he sang with his soul. Phillips always said that Howlin' Wolf was his favorite singer of all the singers he ever produced, including Elvis. He said Howlin' Wolf was probably the best and the best known of his. I'm not a particular big fan of Howlin' Wolf. That's okay. But his most famous song is probably something called Smokestack Lightning. And if you want to hear a good electric Chicago blues record, Smokestack Lightning is something you can look up on your internet and play it. It's out there. One of the great recordings. And then there was a man by the name of Marion Walter Jacobs, better known as Little Walter. He is considered the greatest of the harmonica blues musicians of all time. And this was really important in the Chicago blues. He came a little bit further south. He came out of the Cajun land in Louisiana, came north about the same time as Muddy Waters and Howlin' Wolf. And he got to be accompanying them. And I mean, he is just a phenomenal harmonica player. By the way, all three of these pretty much stayed true to the blues. They never really got out of that genre of music, but they are so important to the development of what became known as rock and roll that they all three have been admitted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. And of course, Muddy Waters himself is just kind of like he's on a different pedestal than the other two. Muddy Waters, probably one of his more famous songs was something called Rolling Stone. It not only gave rise to the rock group, the Rolling Stones name, but it also gave rise to the magazine, which is Rolling Stone. And of course, it gave rise to Bob Dylan's most famous song. He had a tremendous impact upon some of the future rock and rollers, and they pay tribute to him. They say that Muddy Waters was absolutely one of the greatest guitarists and singers of that time. And I'm going to play you a tune here, and this is Muddy Waters on the electric guitar. This is Howlin' Wolf. Folks, it doesn't get musically much better than these two. I mean, these two, you can tell, are just phenomenal musicians. And remember, they stayed pretty true to the blues. So this isn't really rock and roll. This is more blues music, but it's really, really good. So listen up. So that's definitely some pretty good blues music there. And you could hear, you could hear little Walter there in the background playing the harmonica, just fantastic. So they were not the only musicians that Leonard Chess signed. And eventually Leonard Chess realized that there was music to be made in this new genre of music that was becoming well-known, rock and roll. And he originally signed a man that became known to us as Bo Diddley in the early 50s. And Bo Diddley, more than the other three that we just talked about, kind of crossed over into rock and roll. And he became one of the early icons of rock and roll. He was born Ellis McDaniel, born in Macomb, Mississippi, again, Delta region, 1928. He was the son of an unwed 16-year-old girl, and she couldn't take care of him, so she gave him over to a married cousin to be raised as his own, And eventually, the mother, his adopted mother, and him moved to Chicago, and she was very involved in the Pentecostal church, raised him up in the Pentecostal church, and he later said that that trance-like rhythm from the sanctified churches he had attended influenced his trademark guitar style. Well, started playing out on the street corners of Chicago, South Chicago, landed a job with a local nightclub, and Leonard Chess was always going around the nightclub looking for new talent, and he heard Bo Diddley, and he was just really impressed with him. It's strange. Bo Diddley's music is a lot different than a lot of others. Basically, the beat kind of goes back almost to the African rhythms. And Bo Diddley admitted this. He said he was very influenced by the early African songs that he eventually was able to read about and hear. One of the first things that Chess told him was said, you got to get rid of the name. You don't look like an Ellis McDaniel. You got to come up with something catchy. And it said that McDaniel kind of sat around for a few minutes, and he said he remembered as a young child that kids on the plantations where he was raised would play what was called the diddly bow. And that was a Southern practice of nailing a wire to a barn and attaching the other end to a broom, and they would twang it to make a sound. And so he decided he would become Bo Diddley, and that's exactly the name he took. Of course, Bo Diddley became one of the huge stars of the 1950s and 1960s. Very much involved. We talked about him last week in our trivia question. He is the first rock and roll singer to play a song on national TV, the Ed Sullivan Show, in 1955. And remember, he got in a lot of trouble because he was supposed to play 16 Tons, which was being made famous at that time by a country music star by the name of Tennessee Ernie Ford. We'll hear that here soon. And anyway, Bo Diddley decided he was going to go out and play his own song, which he had labeled Bo Diddley. Got him into a lot of trouble with Ed Sullivan. Ed Sullivan was not one to have his rules, as he called them, broken. And as a result, he basically told Bo Diddley, you'll never appear back on my show again. And he never did. You know, I'm not for sure if Ed Sullivan had him back or Bo Diddley just didn't want to go back. But one thing is for sure, he is never back again. So here is Bo Diddley playing on the Ed Sullivan Show, 1955, playing his song. I want you to take a look and pay attention to some of the background people. You can see on their face, you almost can tell that they knew they were in trouble. I mean, it's just like, had this look on their face like, oh boy, I don't think this is going to turn out well. And it did in a way, because he became pretty famous over it. So let's listen to Bo Diddley playing his famous song, Bo Diddley, on Ed Sullivan.
Can't stay.
And so right after that, I'm sure Mr. Sullivan met him backstage and said, "You didn't do what I told you to do. You're gone." So just sit back and think about this for a minute. Here are all these parents in America. They have been raised up listening to the McGuire sisters, to Patti Page, to Doris Day, songs that were just basically calm, quiet songs sung by white, musicians, Perry Como, Frank Sinatra. And all of a sudden, their kids are listening to Bo Diddley. They're listening to, Bill Haley and his Comets pound out Rock Around the Clock at the beginning of a movie, which basically talked about juvenile delinquents. They were absolutely scared to death, folks. I mean, there was a point here in the mid-1955 that there was a real reaction going on to all this music. And people were saying, what can we do about this? We've got to stop it. I showed you a film clip of a preacher, Hank Snow's son, a couple weeks back, just railing against it. It was really getting to the point where most people kind of felt like this was the devil's music. And they were saying, hey, we've got to put a stop to this. This can't go on. Now, the record producers wanted it to go on because they saw dollar signs. They understood what was happening. They knew that they were on the cusp of a new wave of music that was going to come down, that was going to introduce a whole new audience to buying records and play music, the teens. And they were exactly right. And so they somehow felt like, we've got to get control of this. Just so happened that they happened to find a couple of guys that probably saved rock and roll for these record producers. The first one was a man by the name of Fats Domino. Fats Domino was just absolutely a non-threatening black man to the audiences. He was kind of cuddly. He was naturally shy. He was not a big outgoing person. Looked like a big teddy bear. Came from the French Creole area around New Orleans. And just absolutely became a dominant force in early rock and roll. He would sell over 100 million records in his lifetime. He would outsell every other rock and roll singer in the 1950s and early 60s, except for Elvis and Pat Boone. What's ironic about it is he never had a number one hit. All the songs he ever made never hit number one. Now, some of his songs were covered and became number one hits, primarily by Pat Boone. But, he himself never had a number one hit, but he sold tons of records. He didn't even call his music rock and roll. He said, I'm just playing the same old rhythm and blues music I've played my whole life down in New Orleans. But his influence on the music of the 1950s and 60s is absolutely not in doubt. Some of his songs have just went on to become classics, and we're going to hear at least a couple of these classics over the next few weeks. He was inducted into the inaugural class of the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, and like I said, he helped save rock and roll. Had it not been for Fats Domino and Pat Boone, I'm not for sure that rock and roll has survived Bo Diddley, and particularly what came after them, which was Chuck Berry and Little Richard. I'm not for sure that it would survive. Fats Domino just had such an impact upon the music. Like I said, he sang in just such a soft voice. It was mellifluous. He didn't appear threatening. He didn't give off the impression of being someone that was trying to incite your child to play the devil's music. He was just playing some good time music. His first hit was Ain't It a Shame, and he hammered it out in what became known as triplet notes, which kind of became the standard for a long time. You can convert almost any song to rock and roll by using what was called triplet notes, which is basically you played three notes where the normal was just one note. And you'll see this here in just a couple minutes here. He basically got this from a jazz great by the name of Fats Waller, which is where he also got his name, in addition to the fact he was a big man. Well, at least he wasn't tall. He was just big, kind of built like a bowling ball, kind of like me. He played his music on a lot of Alan Freed's early rock and roll shows and actually performed in 1955 in the movie Shake, Rattle, and Roll. And he was a natural entrepreneur. Domino was very intelligent. He realized that if he wanted to make some money, he was going to have to make money out on his own, not for somebody else. So he started his own touring show. And they said that in 1956 alone, he spent 340 nights out on the road, making as much as $2,500 a night. Folks, that's a huge amount of money. That's a huge amount of money today, not just in 1955, particularly for a black man. This was just, I mean, he was, you know, getting rich. However, like many black rock and roll stars of this genre and this generation, the segregated music industry were just a little bit, at least originally, concerned about playing his music. So as it turned out, a lot of his songs, as well as a lot of songs by Chuck Berry and a lot of songs by Little Richard, were covered by a man by the name of Pat Boone. And Pat Boone, of course, would go on to just record, sell millions of records. So let's listen to Fats Domino saying, "Ain't That a Shame." So this is one of the very first really rock and roll songs.
You made me cry when you said goodbye. Ain't that a shame? My tears feel like rain. Ain't that a shame? You're the one to blame. You broke my heart when you said we'll part. Ain't that a shame? My tears feel like rain. Although I cry, ain't that a shame? My tears feel like rain. Ain't that a shame? You're the one to blame. When you said goodbye, ain't that a shame? My tears feel like rain. Ain't that a shame? You're the one to blame. Oh, well, goodbye. Although I cry, ain't that a shame? Tears feel like rain. Ain't that a shame? You're the one to blame.
Okay, so, you know, you can almost imagine a sigh of relief amongst a bunch of parents as they would watch this movie or hear, you know, Fats Domino just saying, well, maybe this is going to be okay after all. It's just a different style than some of the other early rock and rollers had played. But he was nothing compared to Pat Boone. I say, I've got to say it. I think Pat Boone probably saved rock and roll. Just think about it. As I've said, by summer 1955, the white parents of white teenagers, they were worried to death. Their kids were listening to music that evoked fears of rebellion, lust, wickedness. Elvis was out here thrusting his pelvis on the stage. Bo Diddley was pounding out African rhythms on the Ed Sullivan Show. Movies like Blackboard Jungle were driving moms and dads crazy. I mean, they hadn't seen anything like this since the moms had went crazy over Frank Sinatra back in the 40s, the Bobby Sox. So, you know, it was a whole different thing. It was at that time that the record industry came up with Patrick Charles Boone, the anti-Elvis. I mean, it was just like some mad scientist had created this perfect creature to alleviate the fears of rock and roll. I mean, he was as different from Elvis and some of these other early rock and rollers as anybody could be. I mean, he just absolutely was unbelievable. Pat Boone would go on to outsell every other singer in the 1950s, I've told you, other than Elvis. He would hold the Billboard record chart for spending 220 consecutive weeks on the chart with at least one or more songs each week until 2010. I mean, that's a phenomenal record. He specialized in cleaning up and covering rock and roll songs with perfect diction. He removed any kind of sexual innuendo. He would change the words around. He basically just single-handedly made rock and roll more palatable for the parents. So here's good still of rock of Pat Boone. Now, here's a little bit about Pat Boone. Clean cut, you remember, I remember him. He wore white bucks, he wore a suit and a tie. He graduated from Columbia University, magna cum laude. He used perfect diction. It's said that when he decided, first of all, to cover Fats Domino's record, Ain't That a Shame, he said, well, we're not going to call it that. We're going to call it Isn't That a Shame, because that wasn't correct grammar. Well, that switched out pretty fast when nobody wanted to hear that. They wanted to hear Ain't That a Shame. He wanted to be a school teacher. He wanted to be an English teacher. He was raised in Nashville, Tennessee. He kind of married into royalty. He married the daughter of country music legend Red Foley, who was probably the most popular country music star at that point in time. Remained married to her his whole life. He was an outspoken Christian. It's said that in his first movie he made, he was supposed to kiss his co-star, and it said he refused to do it till he went home and talked to his young wife and got her permission to kiss his co-star on the movie. It's also said he was offered a starring role in a movie which was going to star Marilyn Monroe, and he absolutely refused to do it. He said, I won't be in a movie of her. You know, that's not, you know, how I'm going to do it. And, you know, like I said, he was just the anti-Elvis, you know, if you want to say it that. His coverings of Ain't It a Shame, Tutti Frutti, other black hits were just jukebox gold. I mean, he could not have a hit. I mean, he would sing a song and it would go gold almost immediately. Had, as I mentioned earlier, 6 number one hits, 11 top 10 hits, 20 top 40 hits. In addition, he starred in 12 movies, wrote over 20 books, most of them kind of guiding teenagers towards Christianity and clean living. Still living today. He's still out there. He doesn't make as much music as he did anymore. He's almost 90 years old, but I saw just this last week that he was in the news a little bit. Still looks pretty darn good for being almost 90 years old. Surprisingly, he has never been inducted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. And I say that, it's probably not surprising, because in this current generation of the woke culture, he is the very symbol of what's known as cultural appropriation. You know, he is just not the kind of person that the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame thinks ought to be there. I disagree 100%. I think had it not been for him, there probably wouldn't be a Rock and Roll Hall of Fame today. But here is Pat Boone singing his first number one hit. It's the same song we just heard a few minutes ago by Fats Domino. It's called Ain't That a Shame. And, you know, you'll see that it's the same song, but it's sung just a lot differently.
You made me cry when you said goodbye. Ain't that a shame? My tears fell like rain. Ain't that a shame? You're the one to blame. You broke my heart when you said we'll part. Ain't that a shame? My tears fell like rain. Ain't that a shame? You're the one to blame. Farewell, a goodbye, although I'll cry.
Okay, so that's where we're kind of going to stop here, because next week I want to start off a little bit different. Next week, we're going to pick up with what followed Pat Boone and Fats Domino. I'm telling you, if they had not come along, rock and roll would have died, because who followed these two was Chuck Berry and Little Richard. And I'm telling you, if you thought Bo Diddley scared the white parents, you ain't seen nothing until you saw Chuck Berry and Little Richard. They must have been absolutely petrified, but it was okay, because Pat Boone was out there singing the songs, and so was Fats Domino. So I know I'm making this kind of funny, but folks, it really is true. I'm not for sure it would have survived without Pat Boone. He had that much influence on the music. So that's where we're going to pick up next week. We're probably going to hopefully finish 1955. We're going to look at the careers of those two guys, and then we're going to look a little bit at a couple of the country music stars that were real big. One of them was Red Foley, who happened to be the main man behind the Ozarks Jubilee, which emanated from right here in Springfield, Missouri, and almost made Springfield, Missouri the music capital country music. Nashville eventually beat them out, but there was a big period of time there. Everybody thought Springfield was going to be the big country music capital of the world because of the Ozarks Jubilee. So hope you'll stay around and come back to meet with us next week. And, you know, have a good week. And you people out there in Ohio, I hope the sun shines for you sometime.
Yeah. Thank you. Really enjoyed it.
Yeah.
Thank you, Donna.
Yeah.
Thank you, Tony.
Hey, we'll see you.
Thanks, Tony. We'll see you next week, everyone. Bye.
Aylin.